Hello, and welcome to a time of midweek reflection during the season of Lent with the people of Augusta Road Baptist Church. Each Wednesday, as we approach Easter, we are going to be bringing you a time of reflection and prayer to keep us all connected and spiritually focused on our journey together. We encourage you to find space and time. Set aside time to reflect and to pray without distraction. If you are led to take time in silence or to contemplate something that is read during this time, feel free to pause. Pause the video, take all of the time you need, and then when you're ready, resume this time of service and reflection. We do pray that God's Spirit will speak to you and move in you and through you during this experience as you move into this season. Most of the readings of the prayers of this experience, and each of our Lenten experiences really, were written by the Reverend Sarah R. for an organization called A Sanctified Art. We are grateful for this resource. It's providing so much fruit for our spirits during this time as we live together as a congregation. Today, as we reflect, we will be reminded that again and again, we are called to listen to the voice of Christ and to come to his light. This is part of our invitation as a people of faith to not only speak and pray and sing, but to listen. And so often, listening is hard. From the time we're toddlers on up, we struggle to listen, particularly when we don't know what we're listening for, or if we don't agree with what we are hearing. But for just a moment, as we gather ourselves in this time, I want you to join me in a time of a kinesthetic call to worship by embodying our prayer as I prompt you. So let us listen together and let us pray. Family of faith, I invite you to close your eyes for a moment. Rest your feet on the floor beneath you, wherever you are. And I invite you to release any tension that you are holding in your body right now, in your jaw, your neck, your shoulders, your hands, your legs, your feet. Take a deep breath in and slowly let it out. The Hebrew word for breath, ruach, is the same word for spirit. So as you breathe, imagine that it is God who is filling up your lungs with energy and with divine love. Trust that God is as close to you in this time as your very breath. And now I invite you to still your mind. Imagine that your mind is a river, that thoughts will drift into view. They always do. However, instead of holding on to those thoughts, allow yourself to let them simply float by. And listen. Listen deep. Listen far. Listen wide. Listen. The sound of your breath is the sound of the divine within you. You are in holy space. So together, let us connect with God. Amen.
Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praise to him, tell of all his wondrous acts. Glory in his holy name, let the heart of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength, seek his face always. Remember the wonders he has done, his miracles, and the judgments he pronounced. You, his servants, the descendants of Abraham, his chosen ones, the children of Jacob, he is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever, the promise he made for 1,000 generations, the covenant he made with Abraham, the oath he swore to Isaac. He confirmed it to Jacob as a decree, to Israel as an everlasting covenant. To you I will give the land of Canaan as the portion you will inherit. He brought out Israel, laden with silver and gold, and from among their tribes no one faltered. Egypt was glad when they left because dread of Israel had fallen on them. He spread out a cloud as a covering and a fire to give light at night. They asked and he brought them quail. He fed them with the bread of heaven. He opened the rock and water gushed out. It flowed like a river in the desert. For he remembered his holy promise given to his servant Abraham. He brought out his people with rejoicing, his chosen ones with shouts of joy. He gave them the lands of the nations, and they fell heir to what others had toiled for they might keep his precepts and observe his laws. Praise the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Again and again, God meets us where we are. God's love knows no bounds, which is hard for us to understand and easy for us to forget. Therefore, in confession, we remember together that we're not alone. And in a unified voice, we once again ask for God's grace in that holy reminder. Friends and family of faith, I invite you to join me in reading responsively as we pray together in a spirit of confession. And as you are led later on, find your own time to spend in further silent contemplation and confession before God. Let us pray. Listening God, take what is closed in us and open it. Take what is distracted in us and settle it. Take what is hurting in us and hold it. Take any and all parts of us that create distance from you. For we are like Peter, O God. We argue what we do not know. We fear what we cannot see. And we almost always speak sooner than we listen. So open us up, settle us, hold us, and forgive us. We long to hear you clearly. We long to know you more fully. With hope, we pray, and with gratitude, we confess. Amen. Siblings in Christ, we confess with gratitude because we know that God already has heard and forgiven us. No matter what we have done or left undone, we are held in God's hands. So rest in this good news. God invites us in. God meets us where we are. God hears our prayers. God forgives us. Thanks be to God for a love like that.
This is what the Lord says to the people of Israel. Your wound is incurable, your injury beyond healing. There is no one to plead your cause, no remedy for your sore, no healing for you. All your allies have forgotten you. They care nothing for you. I have struck you as an enemy would and punished you as would the cruel, because your guilt is so great and your sins so many. Why do you cry out over your wound, your pain that has no cure? Because of your great guilt and many sins, I have done these things to you. But all who devour you will be devoured. All your enemies will go into exile. Those who plunder you will be plundered. All who make spoil of you, I will despoil. But I will restore you to health and heal your wounds, declares the Lord, because you are called an outcast, Zion for whom no one cares. This is what the Lord says. I will restore the fortunes of Jacob's tents and have compassion on his dwellings. The city will be rebuilt on her ruins, and the palace will stand in its proper place. From them will come songs of thanksgiving and the sound of rejoicing. I will add to their numbers, and they will not be decreased. I will bring them honor, and they will not be disdained. Their children will be as in days of old, and their community will be established before me. I will punish all those who oppress them. Their leader will be one of their own. Their ruler will arise from among them. I will bring him near, and he will come close to me. For who is he who will devote himself to be close to me, declares the Lord. So you will be my people, and I will be your God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Yeah.
Hear now a reading from the Gospel according to John, chapter 12, verses 36 through 43. Christ said, "Believe in the light while you have the light, so that you may become children of the light." When he had finished speaking, Jesus left and hid himself from them. Even after Jesus had performed so many signs in their presence, they still would not believe in him. And this was to fulfill the word of Isaiah the prophet. "Lord, who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?" For this reason, they could not believe, because as Isaiah says elsewhere, "He has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, so they can neither see with their eyes, nor understand with their hearts, nor turn, and I would heal them." Isaiah said this because he saw Jesus' glory and spoke about him. Yet at the same time, many, even among the leaders, believed in him. But because of the Pharisees, they would not openly acknowledge their faith, for fear they would be put out of the synagogue. For they loved human praise more than praise from God. The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. So I was catching up with a couple of our church members this past Sunday as we greeted those who were entering the sanctuary for worship. One of them was sharing with the other two of us about some of the health challenges his aging mother was experiencing. She had a series of strokes, but thankfully had come to a point where she could be in a rehab facility to help her get well enough to hopefully go home. He said she had about a week and a half to go and that she was doing pretty well. And the way he phrased it, it was something like, "We can see the light at the end of the tunnel, but we still have to go through the tunnel." And I love that. What a great way of describing really just about any challenge we could face. We can see the light at the end of the tunnel. There is darkness all around it, but we can see a light off in the distance. It may be as small as a pinprick, but we know it's there. If we keep going, the journey will take us to the point where we come out of the darkness and into the light. But we have to keep going. We have to keep going through the darkness. I think this seems to be a pretty appropriate description of the entire season of Lent as well. I mean, let's be honest, Lent is a dark time. It can be hard to go to worship during Lent. We want to worship in a way that brings joy and energy to our lives and gives us some kind of spiritual high so that we can start the rest of the week on a wonderfully positive note. And then the ministers remind us that we are dust and we're sinners. In a Baptist church like ours, we don't usually make time of personal and prayerful confession a regular part of our liturgy. But during Lent, you'll be prompted more often to think about those things we'd rather ignore about ourselves. We're led to consider the times we have sinned and come up short of what God would want for us. We think about all the opportunities we have to follow the way of Jesus, and we admit to God, but first we admit to ourselves all of the times we decided to choose a different path. We use this 40-day journey with Christ to contemplate forgiveness, salvation, grace, and mercy. Those are the light at the end of the tunnel. But all around us is darkness. And what's worse, it's our darkness, our shadow side, as we call it, the parts of us that are less appealing. Still, there is the light. The writer of John calls Jesus the light of the world. He says that the light was the life of all people. That the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness will not overcome it. And here in the 12th chapter of John, Jesus alludes to the fact that he is the light, standing among the world at that moment. In the midst of the darkness of our lives, there is the light of Christ, constantly drawing us to himself. Now that's the beauty of Lent. Even as we walk through our own darkness and shadows, we know where this journey is heading. We know that as dark as things will get, especially when we get to Good Friday, Easter Sunday is still coming. The light of Christ will be so bright at the resurrection that we will continue to be drawn to it and to him. The darkness the parts of our lives that we would rather ignore, that seems overwhelming right now, is bearable. Because we know that there is and always will be hope as long as we continue to keep our focus on the light that is out ahead of us. John tells us that Jesus performed many signs that showed the light to those around him. He put on display the intervening work of God in the world, and many were drawn to him and believed in him. But there were still many who rejected him. They were afraid of how others would respond when they started to believe in him and follow him. They were afraid of the social, political, and religious implications that came with it. The pressures to go along were too great. Acceptance, relevance, power, and praise among everyone else proved to be too tempting. We know that the 40-day season of Lent is patterned after Jesus' 40 days in the wilderness. It was there in the wilderness as he prepared for ministry that he was tempted with the things that seemed to be warnings for us here in John 12. He was tempted with relevance, with power, and with praise. With each temptation, he turned back to the light of God, maintaining his focus on the task and mission at hand. He gave himself to something greater than the temporary and often tenuous approval of those around him. Jesus would go on to say that what he says are not the words of him alone. They're the words of God, the words that God has given to him. His actions are not his actions alone. They're the actions that God has led him to do. And to reject him, well, it's to reject God. We're constantly reminded that if we want to see God, we need to look at Jesus. If we want to get to know God, we need to get to know Jesus. If we want to know what God likes and dislikes, approves of, disapproves of, look at Jesus. If we want to know how God would act and would want us to act, look at Jesus. And then move toward him and embrace his ways. But to do that, I have to continue to recognize that the darkness in which I walk is made up of all of those other voices and pressures telling me to go a different way and my decision to choose them. Pressures to be liked, to feel relevant, to be popular, to fit in. The pressures to keep silent when I know something is wrong. The pressures to maintain the party line when there is something far greater to work for. The pressure to seek the approval of those around me instead of walking in the way of Christ. Jesus warns that we would be judged for rejecting his ways, the ways of God, and for chasing after something so fleeting as the approval of others instead of living into the relationship and mission of God. But thankfully, he would also remind us that the commands of God lead to life and that he did not come to judge the world, but to save it. He came as the light in the darkness, and the light is still out in front of us, beckoning to us, offering us the chance to live into an identity that doesn't live or die with likes and hearts and opinion polls and views and shares and comments of affirmation. It's an identity as a child of God, one who is deeply loved simply because we were created in God's image. An identity that is so set that no matter how often we go in another direction and move toward the approval of those around us instead of the way of Christ, the light is still there. It is still out in front of us. Believe in it and walk toward it until it envelops you and the darkness is no more. Again, Lent is difficult, mostly because it forces us to acknowledge the darkness within and the darkness all around us. But it also reminds us that the covenant of God that comes through Christ overcomes those things if we would only turn to the light and walk in the light again. So forgive us, Lord, for the times we have listened to and sought the approval of the voices that have caused us to remain in darkness. Call us to your light again. Amen.
Let us pray. Creator God, we cannot hear the trees growing, seeds pushing up through the dirt into the sun. And we cannot hear a single drop of rain, missing one in the many. We cannot hear the weight of people's grief, a burden that so often is silence. And we cannot hear when hearts are changed, but you can. You hear it all. So once again, we come to you with bowed heads and hopeful hearts, asking that you would lend us your ears. Help us to hear as you hear, so that we can live as you lived. We are listening. Amen.
As we conclude our time of reflection today, I invite you to join in reading an affirmation of our faith. We believe. Sometimes our belief is confident, like a child on a dance floor, unashamed and wildly genuine. We believe. Sometimes our belief is distant, flickering and calling out to us, like a lighthouse on the sea. We believe. Sometimes our belief shows up as passion, guiding the way we vote, shop, give, live, trust, and hope. We believe. Sometimes our belief is like a shadow, faith stitched to our heels, unmovable, unlosable, a gift for winding journeys. We believe. Sometimes our belief exists like growing pains. We step forward, we fall back, but again and again, Jesus invites us to listen, to grow, and to take another step. So again and again, we speak these truths out loud. We believe. We believe. Again and again, we believe. Thanks be to God. Amen. May you be blessed by the presence of God's loving and transformative Spirit on this day and in the days to come. And when you find yourself in the midst of darkness, may you remember the light of Christ that continues to draw you in. And never forget that the grace of Christ our Savior, God's boundless love, and the Holy Spirit's eternal and guiding presence are with us all, now and forevermore.